Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for the three that are awake. Come on in, have a seat. Welcome to Cornerstone Bible Church. Looks like the harder pew is going to be fuller today. That is great. That's great. Way to go, Slade. Good recruit. Give this guy a bonus, recruiting bonus. Hey, well, welcome to church this morning. And I was just talking with a student and just recognizing the way in which so often, even in mundane little things of our lives, what comes out, we were just talking about how at our leadership meeting yesterday, a couple different factors had changed in the dynamic, and pancakes were being made different, and hash browns were being made, and how we responded with frustration, maybe because of how long it took, or because it was different, and I just, again, recognizing the depth of God's grace, yet while we were still sinners, yet while we were opposed to Him, He died for us. And that propensity to sin still exists. So I just want to tell you, maybe I've said this before, but take time, the first moments of worship, take time right now as you pray to check your own heart, to see where you're at with God. I love David's prayer at the end of Psalm 139. Search me, O God. Test me. Know me. You know, try my heart that there would not be an offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Obviously, our sin is a problem. And so we come here together, not because we've got our junk figured out or properly stuffed in the closet so no one can see it, but because that junk needs to be reconciled, and we've got the perfect blood of Christ to cover that. So welcome to church this morning. One announcement, there's a men's Bible study meeting this Tuesday, 7 o'clock in the balcony. It's called Goliath Must Fall. It'll be meeting for 6 weeks at 7 o'clock for men. So come check that out if you're interested. Father, again, we do come in here today. We throw ourselves, you know, at the foot of the cross, and we recognize that the price has been paid. Maybe I don't come qualified of my own, but I am qualified by the blood of Christ. The beautiful, precious righteousness of God has been credited to my account, so I can stand before you a blameless, chosen, adopted son. That's true of all of us who put our faith and trust in Christ alone. Right now, God, we humble ourselves and we admit our need for you. And we admit our need for special revelation from God as Nathan brings the word. We admit our need in your help in purifying and cleansing us spirit by revealing our sin. We avail ourselves to you, God. Have your way. We yield to you, Spirit. Take us into new depths and that our worship would be rich and it would proceed for 7 days of this week. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Again, and welcome, and I'm pleased to get to introduce to you again Ethan and Sierra Tabert, and I'm going to invite them up. Ethan and Sierra grew up here for many years, and they are in the process of, I don't know what the official term is for pioneers, but to head to the mission field, and they're going to give us an update on some of the things they've gotten to experience and decisions they've made, the direction they're heading, and where they're at now. And so I hope that not only will you give them your attention this morning, but as we wrap it up, continue to keep them in your prayers. And if there is a way in which you can jump on board and support them in their ministry, it would be very valuable. So thanks for coming and sharing.
So we just wanted to give you guys a little update because last time we were here, we were talking about a vision trip that we were going to go on to Chad to visit a couple different teams. And we can come back and rejoice and say that God provided direction and just a lot of clarity from that trip when we were in Chad. And we have joined a team called the Z Team, and that stands for the Zagawa people because that's the specific people group that our team is ministering to. And so we're going to show a few pictures and just get to talk through some of our experiences and what we'll be doing while we're there.
Sure. Yeah, awesome. So these people here that we're standing with are some of the locals that we got to know best. Some of them are Christian men and some are Muslim, and right now what they're doing is they're actually working at a job where they are translating Bible stories into their own tribal language, so that they can download them onto cards that people can put in their phones and then they can listen to Bible stories. And one really cool story that's kind of come from this is there's a young man who's, he's the one behind Sierra with the really big white turban thing. He's about 19 years old. His name is Mubarak. And about 4 months ago, he became a Christian. And he's the first Zagawa male believer that the team has seen come to the faith. And so that was really encouraging to hear his story and just to see his passion that he has. It was a huge encouragement because oftentimes fruit in Muslim countries is very slow and it's hard. And so that was just really encouraging to see. A little bit of what our timeline looks like before we go. Now through July, we're both working full-time and raising support. And then starting in July through the end of September, we'll be gone out of state on required trainings that we have on part of our organization and our local church in Sioux Falls. And then we're hoping November actually to leave for the field.
So when we're there, our first year will be spent learning the language. We'll be focusing on Chaddy and Arabic as our dialect that we'll be taking language lessons with. But then beyond that, some things that Ethan and I are excited to get to contribute to the team. For me, it would be, there's a doctor and a physician's assistant on the team. And so as a nurse, and especially being a female, coming alongside them and getting to go out and do mobile medical clinics is going to be very valuable. Because in that culture, it's not appropriate for especially two American men to come into a home with just a female present. And so if the husband is gone, which is very common in a Muslim culture for there to be no father figure in the home, it'll be very effective for me to be able to go with them and to get to help the women there. And then another one of my passions is getting to build a relationship with the Muslim women, because in that culture, they're very inferior. And so to be able to go have tea with them and invest in my neighbors and build a relationship and just really plant seeds and speak out statements of truth from the gospel is very important and valuable. And so I'm excited to be able to get to do that. And for Ethan, he will be teaching English classes to 3rd through 6th graders. And that's something that village has asked the Americans to do in their schools, is to teach them English. And so Ethan's excited to be able to take that over from one of the team members and to free them up to go and do other things. And so he'll be doing that. And then helping with some well repairs in that area. There's an NGO that puts in wells, and then it's up to them to maintain them. So those are some of the things that we'll be able to do. We call them platforms, to allow us to help the community and the village. But then obviously our ultimate goal is to be able to build a relationship and seek to make statements of truth and to share the gospel with them, for the goal of building up a sustainable church body in that village so that they can have their church, and then we'll be able to go on and do what Paul did and like build up churches in other villages. But realistically, in a Muslim country, that can take years and decades. And so, I mean, that's our end goal, but we trust the Lord will provide. We're going to go to the next picture.
Yeah, this is a picture of a couple of the families of the team that we're joining. So the team we're joining has 10 adults and 21 kids. So there are a lot of little kids running around over there. And just one evening, we got to go a little bit out of town to a dry creek bed and just enjoy a picnic with them. But we really appreciated just the way that they run the team there and just the way they interact, not only with each other, but with the local people. We just saw ourselves being able to fit in with our gift sets very well in that area. You can go ahead and go to the next slide if you want. So this picture, it's kind of hard to see, but in the background is the city or the village that we'll actually be going to. The village is called Ariba, and it's like 3,000 to 5,000 people, way on the east side of Chad, near the border of Sudan. And Sierra's going to read a verse here from Isaiah 35, just talking about the dry and weary land, but really it's just an analogy for the people's hearts that don't have the Word of God and relationship with God in them. So.
Yeah, this has been our prayer for the Chadian people as we think of their hearts and how they're dry in fact. And this is Isaiah speaking the truth and like the excitement of what it will be. And so it says, "For waters will break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the Arabah. The scorched land will become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water." And we know that can only happen through the water of life that God can provide. And so we're so excited to be able to be a conduit of God's grace to these people. And so we just ask that you would pray with us and join us in praying for the Chadian people, and especially for Mubarak, as he is fleeing for his life and as his family is trying to kill him because of his commitment to follow Jesus. And so these people are special to us, and we know that it's hard for you guys having never met them, but we just ask that you join us in praying for them and for us as we are on this journey of what the next several months look like before November when we take off. So we'll be excited to stay in touch and be connected with you guys, and we're so thankful for the opportunity to get a partner with you from a church that has such a rich history of sending out missionaries.
If I could get a couple of volunteers to come up and pray both for Ethan and Sierra, and then if someone wanted to come and pray for their ministry, and particularly for Mubarak, let's just take a minute to do that.
Oh, Father, we are so grateful for Ethan and Sierra and for their commitment in walking with you, and as they daily, moment by moment, abide in you. What a joy it is to watch a young couple grow and seek your guidance and your direction in their life. And Lord, as they, over the next few months, as they really step into the unknown, step into an area that that only you can really uphold them in, and only you can guide in. Lord, I pray for strength. I pray for a continual trust, a full trust in you in moment by moment. Whether it be from the finances to the unknown of travel to the unknown of working with a team there a little bit, and then with the people. I pray that their hearts are brave for the people there. And but Father, I pray that you would just surround them with your love and compassion, and pour out your Spirit on them each moment, each day as they prepare. Lord, we pray in your name.
Father God, what an honor it is to stand behind missionaries who are obedient to the call to go to the nations. What a humbling thing it is to be able to partner with you in your glory and being agents of change and of the gospel. God, what a hope it is that we have in Christ alone, and what a joy it is to share that with the people of Chad. Go before Sierra and Ethan. Thank you, God. We praise you that you've provided everything we asked for in this trip. You provided gifts. My guess is even gifts that they were hesitant about. They have a vision and a picture for how you're going to use it. God, I thank you for the abundant generosity of your revelation, continuing to show them these things. And I pray that you go before them in these ways, God. Give wisdom for restraint. Give them wisdom for boldness. Give them a clear picture of how this works. Give them patience to wait. To wait on you, Holy Spirit. And then again, yeah, boldness to step in where you open those doors. God, we pray for this young man, especially. God, we don't... better to die young as a believer than to live a long life and spend eternity apart from you. So we thank you for the salvation of this young man. We pray in the name of Jesus for protection. We pray, God, that this young faith, like the seed that is planted and grows up to produce 100-fold, we pray that his life is one that is lived under the glory of God. I would pray that he becomes a vital part, a vital catalyst of the gospel going forth in Chad, Father, as a picture of this intimacy that we get to have through Christ with our Father. And would you use him in a mighty way, setting him apart, even now, in the name of Jesus, setting him apart to have a ministry that reaches thousands, God. Churches planted, souls saved, and lives changed, communities changed through this young man. Thank you, God, for the things in advance that you're going to do because of this obedience. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, we thank you that you have given us this honor as a church to send this couple out to serve you. Help us to be faithful in our support of them and to care for them always, to lift them up to you, and to give you the praise and glory for it. Amen.
Father, I just pray a big amen to these other prayers, and thank you for Sierra's faith and willingness to obey you, and just pray for continued growth in their faith and their confidence in you, and to know that they got a rough spots ahead, but we thank you that they are in your hands and that you are faithful. And Lord, just pray for the people in Chad, that this God of people, that you would be bringing sort of moving your spirit there to bring a spiritual renewal or a revival or awakening, that people will acknowledge that you are God, that Jesus is the Son of God, and these people will, their eyes will be opened to that truth. And I thank you for your opportunity to be here. Just thank you for the sincerity to get out and be a part of that, and as they follow your leading.
We pray for the Z team who's there already, and just knit them closely together as brothers and sisters in Christ that are walking in you together, enjoying your presence, your power, your blessing, and as they recognize your hand is on them, Lord, to do the work that you have called us to do, that you are gifting us to do, that you are empowering us to do, that they would walk in that and find a joy in just giving you the glory, even through the hard times, even when it's difficult, Lord, that you would give them wisdom to help them to make the connections as a team with one another and also with the community, and to see, Lord, the love that you bring to our hearts because of your love for us. May it continue to transform them and build them up to be a light to that community and to the region. And Lord, I pray that you would bring forth a new and living water, that you would be the water, the living water that nourishes the souls and the hearts of the people, and may their thirst draw them to yourself, and may that be evident. And Lord, I pray that you would satisfy and nourish in a powerful way. In your name we pray. As we continue with our prayer time, you'll notice there are several requests in the insert. An update from Darwin and Karen, as well as a few local requests. Several of them have been mentioned before, so we don't have to go through them all. One of them that did not get mentioned last week, and I forgot to put it in this week, we sent it out as an email, and that is that Daryl Heidi, his son Brent, did pass away. It would be about a week and a half ago, almost 2 weeks ago, and he had shared that, and it was pretty tragic and very difficult for the family. He just asked for prayer, that he was struggling as an alcoholic and had relapsed, gotten back into it, and had passed away. They were investigating that as well, to see what caused it, but just very difficult for them to lose their son. And so pray for them and for his friends and those who are affected by it, that the Lord would continue to work through that situation. Are there other prayer requests, praise items, that you'd like to share with us? I know there's Stacy. Since I know Stacy is going to share something, so.
So, a little life update for me, just so you all know. I don't know how many of you heard about my kind of little idea of going to Ireland for a while. I'm actually not going to do that, so that's kind of a side note. So, what I think I'm doing is I'm graduating college in May, so woo. And then after that, I'll be going straight to Ministry of Forest Springs. So that's where my sister Therese is at, and that's where I've had a couple great summers of ministry as well. So what the program is that I'll be doing, it's called LTD, Leadership Training and Development, and I'll be learning how this camp runs. I'll be helping out. I'll be working with the kids, working with the other staff. But at the same time, I'll be taking classes and learning how to run a Christian camp well. So it's pretty exciting. We get to kind of travel all over the Midwest and visit different camps, see how they do things, and ultimately create our own dream camp, which I'm pretty excited about. So. It'll be a full year from May until next April or May. And so that's what I'm doing next, and I'm really excited about it. So if you guys could just be praying for me as I continue to do college, and that I'll finish well, and then also that my heart will be prepared for the ministry that I'm going to do this summer, and just for my class as LTD, that we will have unity, that we will be an encouragement to each other. And then also, specifically this summer, I'll be a wilderness trip leader. So even just praying for children's hearts, or like youth's hearts, to be changed through that experience of just getting out into the wilderness and in a new environment can be really impactful in kids' life. And then also safety, because you never know what you're going to run into. So yeah, that's me.
Thanks for that update. Any other prayer requests or prayer prayers? All right, let's spend some time in prayer together. Dear Lord, we do just lift up your name. You are a God worthy of all of our praise. And Lord, I pray that our lives would be a sacrifice of worship to you, that every day that we live for your glory, and that our lives would be able to reflect that as we communicate the truth in a world that often is influenced by Satan, the deceiver, and who even deceives us. Lord, I pray that you would use us as a body to bring truth to each other's lives, to speak life, and to share love, and to build one another up in powerful ways. Lord, I pray that as a body, we can then have an impact in this world. It's not about us, it's about you. And it's about them finding the life they've been created for, which is only found in you. I pray for Daryl and Susan, as they struggle with the loss of their son, but also find hope in his faith, even despite the challenges he faced. Lord, I pray that you will just continue to minister to them, encourage them, speak through them into the lives of some of his friends, and the opportunity just to share with them the hope that we have, even beyond the grave. I pray for Stacy as she's heading to Camp Four Springs this summer. I pray that as she wraps up her schooling, you'll continue to use her there on campus and in the lives of the fellow students, that she could also be a witness and testimony for you. And as she prepares to go to camp, Lord, I pray that it will be a valuable time of training, of encouragement, of growth, just to see how you can use a ministry like camp to touch people's lives and help them grow in a very deep and powerful way. Lord, that you might use her as someone who is both equipping and serving and establishing kids in their own walk with you, and that you use her effectively for that. Lord, we pray that you continue to guide us as a church, that we would just walk with you, abiding in your work in our lives, and then willing, eager to share that both with one another and with the community. Lord, may your love flow through us. Give us a heart that's willing to reach out. I know there's times where our lives are always busy, but even in the busyness and the things that we're doing, Lord, may we continually be pointed to you, walking with you, and encouraging others in that. And Lord, willing to examine our priorities and to say, Lord, we want you and building your kingdom to be at the top. So examine our hearts and how we can do that better as a church. I pray that you guide us in that as a leadership, as we look to just increasing the impact we can have in making disciples, that we would be able to learn from you, grow in you, and reflect you more clearly. Lord, I pray that as even now as we bring these gifts and offerings, that we give them not out of hearts that are just doing this because we're supposed to, because you want us to, Lord, but ultimately it's because we recognize who you are, and it is a heart of worship, a heart that recognizes we are here to build your kingdom. And that's what we want to happen through this body. And together, Lord, we are called to do this. And I pray that you work within each of our hearts, that not only would our gifts be given to you for your glory and your work, but that our lives would be lived to you and for you each and every day. In your name we pray.
Oh, good morning, everyone. Let's stand as we continue worship time and spend this time in recognizing God's provision. God's provision from moment by moment, every day. Not just in things, but all the blessings that He's given us. Amen. Thank you.
And thank you for joining us today. And one of the questions that came up last week as we began looking at this topic, that work is worship. And the question that came up is, well, what is worship? So what would make work worship? And so I want to show this short video clip that kind of sets the stage as we continue this. And it identifies that worship is so much more than just what we do on Sunday. Church on Sunday, it happens every day, everywhere we go, and all that we do, we are here to devote ourselves to Him, to bring glory and honor to Him, and to lift up His name. We are here for His glory. And the mindset of a believer is, realizes that I don't just worship on Sunday, or I don't just worship as I get to spend time, you know, in a personal devotional life with Christ. It's then as I go out, my life becomes a reflection of Him and of the transformation He must make in me. So even our work becomes worship. So let's just say, if our work becomes worship, And I could invite, I could invite two farmers up here, you know, like Perry and Wayne. You guys want to come up here real quick? And you guys both are involved in farming. And I know you're comfortable coming up because you were both up here praying before, so we know you're, right, you're spiritual men. How much is your work a part of worship? But here's a silly question. So if your work is worship, then does your work, like, how would you say my work is worship? Does it depend on, as farmers, how much bushels per acre your crops yield? Would you be worshiping God more by producing more? You think so? So that's not like you can say, hey, I worship God more because my crops do better, right? Well, and why not?
Well, like the song was saying, it's like my hope is built on nothing less, so it's like that.
Mm-hmm.
I sung that song to myself during harvest.
Right.
When the yields aren't quite what I wanted them to be.
Right.
It's like my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood.
Okay.
My hope is not built on the yields.
So your hope isn't built on your yields, and the reason you're raising the crop, it's not just good yields are what show God that you have a heart of worship. It's what you put in there. How about you for you, Wayne? How do you get, I mean, aren't we supposed to live for excellence? And isn't excellence mean raising great crops?
Well, I think there's a certain point of...
I'll give you a mic here if you want. Oh, you got one.
There we go. Well, I think...
I'm putting them on the spot. So.
There's a little bit of that. I mean, I think what we do reflects what we feel about God, what we understand by Him. And so if we do everything with a, you know, poor attitude, even an attitude of not caring,
mm-hmm.
that is a reflection of who we serve.
Right.
So does it mean excellence? I don't know if it means excellence, but it means that we're doing it with an overflow of who we understand Him to be. That doesn't always end up in being a millionaire or being the best farmer, but it reflects who God is, and that's comes from the heart.
All right, no, thanks. You can put those down, but thanks for your help. But work is worship doesn't just become, like I would say, it's like a brag fest, saying, ha, look what I did, because in the end, if it's just about who produces the most crop, who would they be worshiping? Maybe it's production. You know, it's saying, hey, this is what we worship, is giving great yields. Or it could be worshiping themselves, saying, look at what I did compared to what you did, and putting the other one down. And so it's not becoming a brag fest. And so this is where work is worship. Whether I'm a pastor, I don't get to brag about attendance or baptisms or this and that. If I'm a teacher, I don't get to brag about test scores. If I'm a salesman, I don't get to brag about profits and sales and, that in the end, but is it a reflection of who I am when I want to do the best I can? And it's not for my glory, ultimately it's for God's glory, because what does God deserve? He deserves so much more than just I do. It's about pointing people to God. And the mindset of believers is that my work does matter to God. What I do matters, how I do it matters, why I do it matters, and those things are all a part of it. And so in the end, if what I do and how I do it and why I do it affects my bottom line, so the profits aren't as big and the yields aren't as great, or it may be that, yes, doing the best I can with the resources I have, the time I have, but that may mean not even making the best yields. There's other times it might be doing the best I can, and God does bless and provide. So ultimately what matters, it's not the yield. It's not the number of students, the greatest profits, the most production, the biggest numbers. It's not that. God looks at our hearts and begins to examine what's going on the inside. And so this, one of the things in Ephesians it says is, as we are becoming like Christ, that He renews our mind. And that we're to put off the old self. We're supposed to be renewed in the spirit of our mind and put on the new self. So what does this renewed mindset look like in regards to work, so that work can become worship in my everyday life. This renewed mindset, I want to look at, if you have your Bibles, open to 1 Timothy chapter 6. And there's a passage there that talks about, what started off is looking at this idea of stewardship. When God entrusts something to you, what does he expect of you? And because how we handle what we've been entrusted with reflects a heart of worship. And what we see here in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19, it starts off and it says, instruct those who are rich in this present world. And so this instruction comes to those who, and when it says rich, I'm going to say we've been entrusted as stewards with wealth. So we have possessions, and whether you compare them to those who have less than you or more than you is whether or not you think, and our society says you're rich or not, but you have wealth. You've been entrusted with something. And therefore, I'm going to say, for today's sake, you can consider yourself rich. You have resources. You have things that God's entrusted to you. It's interesting in chapter 6, verse 6, it says, godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment. And so if you have godliness and contentment, what do you have? It's a means of great gain. So if you have great gain, that means you're rich, right? So I'm maybe stretching that a little bit. But when you're serving the Lord, he's entrusted you with the possessions you have. How are you supposed to use them? And here's what he says. Here's what he says. Number one, fix your hope. Not on the uncertainty of riches, but on God. There's a contrast here. Where are we to fix our hope? A renewed mindset puts its hope, fixes its glory. It's wanting to make great of what? Of the wealth or of God? We want to put our hope on God. He is at the foundation of our life. And so a renewed mindset is seeking to give praise, honor, and glory to God. And what we describe is this economy of labor can be identified this way. And Alan, go ahead and hit the next, advance the next slide. So in the economy of labor, we have three spheres. There's a sphere that is God. He is the creator. And he's made everything, creation. And that creation is made by him, is made for him, and then the third sphere is that we as mankind have been made as stewards. And we talked about that last week, that God created us in his image as his representatives on this earth to have dominion, to subdue, to cultivate, and to care for creation. And that's what we talked about last week, that we are stewards of it. And so there's these three spheres of labor, and as man, our job isn't to fix our hope on the creation, but what is the direction that we are to fix our hope? And we are to put our attention, and we are to give the glory for it. It's towards God. And I'm pointing that way, but you guys are looking this way. So it's up towards God. That's where we are to put our focus. That's where we are to fix our hope. In John 1:1 it says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And then it says that all things came into being through him. Nothing, apart from him, nothing has come into being. That is, he's created all things. In Hebrews 1, it talks about how Jesus is the creator, how he is the sustainer. Everything is here because of him. And ultimately, he's in authority over it, and he is the judge of it. As the creator, he deserves all the glory. And I know we talked about in Sunday school a few weeks ago how he is a jealous God that does not want to give his glory to anyone else. And that's called idolatry, when we start worshiping the created thing rather than the creator himself. And so God wants us to keep our focus, our attention on him as the creator. We are to put our hope in God. The creation itself was created to reflect his glory. In Psalm chapter 19, verse 1, you read some of these, that even the heavens declare the glory of God, their expanse. It points people to his handiwork and the greatness of what he's done. It declares the work of his hands. Day to day pours forth speech. Night to night reveals knowledge. That what God has created in this world as creation ultimately points to him. And Alan, you can go back. We're still here on glorifying God. That the creation even is created to glorify God. That's what he's designed it for. You read some of the Psalms. Psalm 96 is another example. And in Psalm 96, you see that many of the Psalms, they point to how it's created. The creation is to glorify God. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Bless his name. Proclaim good tidings of his salvation from day to day. Tell of his glory among the nations, his wonderful deed among the peoples. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. As you read on down, it talks about in verse 11 and 12, let the heavens be glad, let the earth rejoice, let the sea roar and all it contains, let the field exult, all that is in it, and all the trees of the forest will sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. He is coming to judge the earth and judge the world in righteousness. I mean, it talks there about the creation singing and declaring and saying and praising God. Is it automatically advancing through those, Alan? No, why don't you go back? We're still here on talking about we're designed to glorify God. And so this is the creation and what it's designed for. And to mankind, we've been made as stewards. And as stewards, as we cultivate and create, as we have dominion, the focus of our work with creation isn't that the creation gets our attention apart from God, but rather that we, as we steward it, as we have dominion over it, we bring it back from the effects of the curse back to pointing back at God. So we point at God and creation points at God. Both of us are pointing towards God. And that's part of our work. Work has a direction. It's not an end of itself. In the end, the goal is to glorify God. And not only does 1 Timothy 6:17 say, don't fix your hope on the uncertainty of riches, but fix it on God. And as we do that, it says, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. That as we walk with God and glorify him, there is a joy in that as we get to enjoy the creation he's made. And we get to enjoy walking with him and glorifying him. There's several verses that talk about how work becomes one way in which we get to glorify God. And work is not just something as we leave church on Sunday and go about our work, it's just a mundane, we just go and do it just because I've got to pay the bills, I've got to make a paycheck. But even in our work, we're supposed to have the attitude of glorifying God. In Sunday school this morning, we talked about that we can go to work day after day and it just becomes monotonous. It just becomes ritual. It just becomes a habit, a discipline. But you know what? Going to church can be the same thing. It can be a habit. It can be discipline. It can be ritual. And it can become very empty. In fact, Jesus even told Pharisees, if all you're doing is going through the rituals, they're worthless. That going to work, in the end, sure, there's value in discipline, but the ultimate purpose is that there's a direction that it's pointing. And that is, it's pointing up to God. In Colossians 3:23, it says, whatever you do, and this is written, Colossians, so again, like Ephesians, in Colossians, they're writing of the impact of who Christ is, of what he's done, that he is our sufficiency, and in him, we've been made complete, we've been forgiven, we've been reconciled to God, we are now his children and blameless and in the faith, and he says, therefore, set your mind on things above, and walk in a way that honors and glorifies him as his word dwells in us. And he says, this is how it affects you as husbands and wives, as children and parents. And then in chapter 3, 22, as slaves, it affects us. Verse 23, whatever you do, do your work with all of your heart as for the Lord rather than for men. Very clearly, the direction that our work is to point is we're doing this for the Lord. We're not just serving men in our work, even as employees, even as here, as slaves. Slaves who have no choice in what they do. Their responsibility is to obey their masters Verse 22 says, slaves, in all things, obey those who are your masters on earth, not with external service only, as those who merely please men, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, do your work with all your heart, as for the Lord, rather than for men. This is reflected in 1 Peter 4:11. It says, whoever serves is to do so as one serving by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20 says, you are not your own, you've been bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body. That we want to point people to God. We are here to glorify Him. And ultimately, as we serve as stewards, we do that because we love Him. Out of, as He's loved us, we now love Him. Our love is not for creation. It's not for the things of this world. Our love is for God. And so we want to point people there. And that's why it says we don't fix our hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God. And He has provided. He has provided in a wonderful way. I'm focusing here on 1 Timothy 6, but just earlier in that chapter, one of the verses I already read is, godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment. For we have brought nothing into the world, we do not take anything out of it either, but this contentment comes as we have a love for God and walk in a way that honors Him. There's not a continual striving and a love for more and more stuff. There's a contentment that says, I have found the source of all that I need, and that's God, so I don't have to keep striving and trying to fill the emptiness in my life with things. My hope is in God. In Matthew 6:21, it says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Later on, it says, you cannot serve both God and money. There's a choice we have to make. What are we going to live for? And is our love, is the work that we do on an everyday basis, what am I serving? Who am I serving? Why am I doing what I'm doing? Can my work more and more become an act of worship? Because I am not serving money. I'm not serving things. I'm not just doing what I'm doing to pay the bills and to get by. I'm doing it because with all my heart, I'm serving God and not just man. What often happens is we get our hope misplaced. Instead of placing our hope in God, we place it in creation. What we start doing is we start trying to find our security or safety in that. So we start taking things, even things that don't belong to us. That's why theft is wrong. Coveting is wrong. Because our attention is in the wrong place. Our attention is on the creation, not on the Creator. We find value in pursuing things rather than in pursuing God. And that's why a part of God's commands to us and His concern for us is that our heart is in the right place. It's focused not on the things of this world, but on loving God. So if we're to glorify Him, He is at the center of what we love and what we care for. All right, so a new renewed mindset seeks to glorify God. It flows out of a love for God, knowing who He is, His glory, His greatness, and His love for us, wanting to honor and glorify Him in every way, because He's the one that can supply us, who richly supplies us with all good things to enjoy. He is the source of life that we want to glorify and lift up. The next point I want to make is a renewed mindset not only glorifies God, a renewed mindset utilizes creation for good. So it uses... Oh, my battery's dead. So I don't know if you want to switch mics or bring me up a new battery, but I think it's going dead. A renewed mindset uses creation to do good. And here's what it says in verse 18 now. So those who have fixed their hope in God, it says then, instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works. And then the third part is to be generous and ready to share. And so I'm going to focus now on the first two of those. It says we are to do good and be rich in good works. So the question is, what does it mean to do good? What is doing good? Is good a subjective term or an objective term? In other words, And, you know, in our society, they want to say, well, what's good for you might not be good for me. What's good for me might not be good for you. So you can do what's good, and I can do what's good, and it might not be good for each other, right? Or is good, is goodness, is it more objective in that it's defined not by our own personal opinions of what's good or not, but ultimately by the Creator and His definition of what is right and wrong and good and bad. I believe there is an objective standard. It might be difficult for us all to come to the exact same conclusion in every detail on what that means, but there is a God who's created this world, and He created it. When He created it, He said it was very good. What He made was good. And because of the fall, it has been corrupted. But God's desire for us now is to do good. And I think we could do good even before the fall, that we could continue the goodness that He was doing. Now we get to reflect that as His representatives, bearing His image on the earth. We got to continue this goodness, and as we would have dominion, as we would cultivate, as we create, we could do good things that reflected the very nature of the Creator who did what was good. And now He invites us into that. So our relationship with creation in our work, my vocation becomes an act of worship as what I do with what He's entrusted me with, I utilize these resources for good, to reflect His nature, to reflect the order and the beauty and the goodness and the truth of what He's created to be. Sierra, it interested me that numerous times you said part of your role was to help them come to understand truth. Like, what is truth? And I think part of our job in this world is to reflect truth. That is, there's an innate goodness to what is true. What is right? What is good? And it's not something we have to debate and say, well, what's true for them isn't true for us. No, there is an objective standard of truth that we need to help people see. And in our work, do we point people to that truth? Do we point people to that goodness? Do we point people to God's design? Really, it's for the benefit of mankind as a whole. It doesn't just take what I want versus what you want and say, well, who's stronger, who's bigger, who's more important, so then I get what I want, or you get what you want. It says, no, what is good ultimately for the greatest number. We also can see it reflects in this goodness, there's a sense of, I think, not only truth, but also beauty. That beauty is not just a subjective standard, that what you think is beautiful might be, you know, ugly for others. I think as a result of the fall, sure, we all can have different definitions, but in the end, I think there's a reflection of beauty, that in my work, am I doing things that create goodness? Am I doing things that reflect truth? Am I doing things that allow for beauty to be continue to be developed and extended? So we are to do good. We are to be rich in good works. That what we do begins to reflect the goodness, the beauty, the truth of our Creator. Ultimately, again, what we do is pointing people to this standard who is God. And when people see it, they are, oh, wow, creation reflects the beauty of God. I mean, we were watching a YouTube video on some of the neat inventions, and they have these like, I don't know, did you see the Olympics? They had the drones make the Olympic rings and all that. I mean, that was pretty cool, wasn't it? I mean, there's a sense in which there is a beauty and an awe and I'm like, wow, to that, right? But it only reflects in a small way the beauty and the awe and the wonder of what our Creator has made. I mean, technology is just beginning, and so some of the things we were seeing is drones that have wings like a bird, and robots that walk like animals, you know, with four legs and things, and it was neat to see it, but that's nothing compared to the real thing. I mean, that's just a robot that can barely, you know, carry something around or lift it up. When you have animals that are here doing that since the beginning of creation, there's a goodness in what God has done. And so in our work, are we reflecting the goodness of our Creator? There's value in that. So there's value in the art and the media if it points people again to the Creator. There's value in all that we do. This one of the things that Johann Bach did in his work as a musician was to point people to God. At the end of every piece of work that he would write, he would leave it with the initials SDG. Soli Deo Gloria, to the glory, or only to God be the glory. That in his work, and there is almost a universal agreed upon beauty and goodness in what he created, that all the world uses his compositions and says, wow, these are good. That what he did, his work, pointed people to God and reflected the goodness and the beauty and the glory of God. And likewise, in our work, are we doing that? So as a farmer who raises crops, I think, again, we can point to goodness and beauty and glory. And it may mean raising crops, whether it be in sustainable ways. There's new ways to talk about it. It's ways that are responsible and stewarding, but also that are productive, that aren't wasting resources and wasting and not harming other things, whether it's in what's done. But there's a goodness that our work begins to reflect. All right, lastly, a renewed work mindset loves people. Not only does it glorify God and uses creation to do good, a renewed work mindset loves people. That how we treat others in the process is vitally important. That our work becomes worship, not because I'm using people at their expense for my good, but I'm loving people in the process. It brings in the grace, the generosity, the gratitude, the appreciation for what people do. And in fact, in verse 18, it says, instruct people to do good, to be rich in good works, and then it says, to be generous and ready to share. That as we work, our work becomes worship. It affects how we treat the people around us. That there is a generosity in it. Generosity means being liberal. We're giving people more than they deserve. That word is used in Matthew chapter 20, where it's the parable of the landowner who needs hired workers. And so he goes out and brings some guys to his field, and they agree to work for a day's wage. And he sees the work's not going to get done, so he goes back and he brings more workers out the third hour. And he still sees the work's not going to get done. So he goes back and gets more workers and brings them out the sixth hour. And then again, even at the ninth hour. And when it's come time to pay him, he brings the people who came last and only worked a few hours of the day, and he gives them a full day's wage. Then he brings the next guys and gives them the same amount. And the next one's the same. And the last one's come up and said, we worked a whole day, and you're just giving us a day's wage? And he says, well, that's what we agreed to. Do you have a problem with me being generous? Giving them more than they deserve. And God calls us, if we have possessions, if we've been entrusted with those who are rich in this world, we are to be generous. And to be ready to share. That it's not just about hoarding and keeping things to ourselves, that we're supposed to use them for the blessing and benefit of others. So, a renewed mindset. Our work ethic is to demonstrate a heart of love and care for others. We see this elsewhere in Scripture, even in the Golden Rule, to treat people the same way you want them to treat you. There's a generosity, a love, a grace that wants to care for others. This is commanded of slaves. In every regard, consider your masters worthy of all honor. And then it says, especially those who are believers, but even those who are unbelievers are worthy of all honor. We are to be generous with them in how we honor them. Not because they deserve it, but because this is what God has called us to. Colossians 3:22, it says, in all things obey your masters with a sincere heart. Ephesians 6, again, says that same thing, obey with a sincere heart as to Christ. You are to treat the people around you, even your boss, as if he is Christ himself. What? That's being generous, right? Rendering service as to the Lord, knowing whatever good thing you do, you will receive this back from the Lord. Masters, if you're the boss, You're to be generous. Grant your slaves justice and fairness, knowing you too have a master in heaven. Ephesians 6:9 says, masters, do the same thing to them. Give up threatening, knowing that both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no partiality. In James 5:4 says, we'll be held accountable. The wages we fail to pay our workmen, they cry out against us. That when we lack the generosity God calls us to, there's an accountability to that. So it's not our desire to withhold from others, but to give beyond what we owe them as an act of worship, as if we're giving it to the Lord himself. So we can be generous with our goods, sharing with those in need. Ephesians 4:28 says, let him who steals steal no longer, but rather work hard so that he has something to share with others. Leviticus 19, in the law itself, it calls the men who are working in the fields to leave the edges, to leave the, I don't know what you call it, the overflow, you know, the things that, the grain that falls out while you're harvesting, and leave it so that the poor can come and they can glean, not so that they can just be given a handout, but so that they can come and work, find value in what they're doing, and have then what they need. What does that look like today? What are the gleanings? What are the, you know, what is the overflow or the leaving the corners? What does that look like in today's society? How do we do that for those who are poor? I mean, we have a welfare system. Is that it? Sometimes it seems like it becomes more just an empty handout. But we are commanded to help, to share, and so we're doing that. But how do we do it in a way that also builds up dignity, that builds up and encourages responsibility? Those are great questions to ask. How can we be generous? How can we continue to share with those who need what God has called us to? And in the end, what is a God-sized vision for our vocation? What is a God-sized vision? It's about storing up, not a treasure here on this earth, but it says in verse 19, storing up for themselves a treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. As we worship God in our work, we get to take hold of that which is life indeed. We really get to live, not because we find satisfaction in all the things we get, but because we find satisfaction in the God who made us, to honor him, to love others, and to cultivate within the creation what is good, beautiful, and true, and point people to him. There is a rich wealth in what he's called us to. Dear Lord, I pray that each of us would continue to develop a God-sized vision for our vocation. Lord, whether it's me as a pastor, Lord, I see many areas in which I could reflect you and glorify you and live for you more wholeheartedly. And with greater skill and ability to reflect the goodness of your creation and how you've designed things to run. Lord, I pray that as men and women who are working at home, in classrooms, in offices and in businesses and out in the fields and in whatever they're doing, Lord, that you would continue to give them a God-sized vision for their work. That they would see it as an opportunity to bring glory and honor to you, that they would do it well, with excellence, that they would do it with integrity, worship, keeping their focus on you and doing it to bring honor and glory to you, that they would do it just with a heart of love and compassion for others. Lord, I pray that in every way you would be glorified through our lives, that our worship would not end as we leave here on Sunday morning, but our worship would continue throughout the week as we walk with you into our workplace. And bring glory to you, Lord, as we are going, help us then to make disciples, leading others to live a life of worship for you as well. In your name we pray. Amen.